I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
One of London's most famous landmarks, St. Paul's Cathedral, is dedicated to Christianity's first theologian and, after Jesus himself, arguably its true founder, the Apostle Paul. It was Paul who first took Christianity out of its Jewish-Palestinian setting and transformed it into a world-beater. It was Paul and his followers who created much of the Christianity we know today. A religion of salvation by faith in Jesus, a pre-existent divine being sent to earth by God to save us all from our sins. Much of the dogma that surrounds Jesus was created by Paul. Paul describes himself as the apostle to the Gentiles, or as we'd know them today, pagans. Paul was supremely practical in terms of converting non-believers. And he even admits in his letter to the Corinthians, I have become all things to all people, that I might win them to Christ. And what he meant by that was that he was willing to adapt and adjust himself to whatever circumstances he found himself. And if that meant a little bit of borrowing from pagan religion, then so be it. My search for the hidden Jesus has now brought me to the north of England, to the border of the Roman Empire, Hadrian's Wall. When Jesus first appeared 2,000 years ago, he was born into a world full of pagan gods. And if he was to survive, he would need to compete on their terms. And this could mean reworking some of the best ideas that had already existed for thousands of years. Just after the Second World War, there was an incredible series of archaeological discoveries in the UK. They revealed a network of Roman temples from London in the south to Hadrian's Wall in the north. They were dedicated to a pagan religion that existed at the same time as Christianity, and to a god who had striking similarities to Jesus.
He, the awful and overpowering, worthy of sacrifice and prayer. Mithra, the lord of wide pastures.
And Mithras is a god to the good side, I presume, the light.
Yes, Mithras was the lord of light. He was basically attached to the sun god, who ordered Mithras to go and kill the primeval bull to release life force for the benefit of mankind.
And that's interesting symbolism there. Yes. So you've got this powerful deity and then this kind of sub-deity who acts as a kind of saviour figure for humankind.
The rise of Mithras almost exactly parallels the rise of Jesus, although his origins could be much more ancient. Some say he was created by the Romans, others that he came from Persia and India. So if Mithras predated Jesus and is also a savior god who offered his followers a life after death, did Christianity steal these ideas?
It was a mystery cult. We certainly know that they were having ritual meals. It seems to have been a fairly basic feast, based largely on the chickens, on bread and on wine.
Bread and wine?
Bread and wine, yes.
You know, it's got similarities with early Christianity, the sense of feasting, the sense of discipline. You don't have to appease the deity, you work at things for your own good. There's a deity who is a god of light, who is sent by a major deity to kill his nemesis in order to redeem and save the world.
Yes, the early Christian fathers, who wrote a lot, were very upset about Mithraism. They thought that Mithraism was parodying Christianity.
So there is potentially a crossing of ideas and even potentially a merging of ideas between Mithras and early Christianity. Potentially.
You don't know whether at this point Christianity and Mithraism are all getting rather intertwined and it's getting confused.
Mithras was a pagan god, with a story, a purpose, and elements of ritual very similar to that of Jesus. but one whose origins could predate him by thousands of years. But
the fact is that Mithraism failed to survive, and it was Christianity that conquered the Roman Empire. But we do know that early Christian fathers were very worried about the similarities between Christianity and Mithraism, especially the charge that Christianity borrowed many of its ideas from this pagan cult. So when paganism was officially outlawed, particular animosity was shown towards Mithraism. Many of its temples were destroyed, and others had churches built on top of them. But Mithraism did leave one mark on Christianity. When later church fathers were deciding what anniversary to celebrate the birthday of Jesus, they chose December the 25th, the winter solstice, which also happens to be the birthday of Mithras.
Is Jesus was the solar deity of the Gnostic Christian sect, and like all other pagan gods, he was a mythical figure. It was the political establishment that sought to historize the Jesus figure for social control. By 325 AD in Rome, Emperor Constantine convened the Council of Nicaea. It was during this meeting that the politically motivated Christian doctrines were established, and thus began a long history of Christian bloodshed and spiritual fraud. And for the next 1600 years, the Vatican maintained a political stranglehold on all of Europe.